It will answer my prayer. It will answer your prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's open our hymn to hymn 72. Hymn 72. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend, but only name on Jesus' name. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, fortunate to stand before the throne, O Christ, the solid Christ. The solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Praise the Lord. Stand beside the scripture.
Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We bless your holy name. We give God a praise for whom you are. Father, we ask that you will speak to us today. It's not by might, it's not by power, but by your spirit. Let your spirit flow in our heart through your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us sit here. Today we'll be looking at the topic that is in the outline and not on the search the scripture book. The outline thing is attached to the program. With every believer reaching every creature for Christ. Can we say that together? If you're a believer, say it again. Every creature for Christ. So I'll do try as much as possible to carry every one of us along so that we'll be able to get the core of what this lesson is actually talking about, of what it's trying to teach us. Because it cuts through an entire event, and God's purpose and his mission for us as believers. From the topic, every believer is reaching every creature for Christ. So talking about believers, you as a Christian who have received Christ into your life as your personal Lord and Savior, those who are born again, repent of their sin, and living the life according to what God has instructed, you are a believer. If you are born again through your life to Christ, you are a believer. And it says, as a believer, we are to reach every creature for Christ. Men, women, young and old. In every places, in every city, we are to reach them for Christ. Let's open to Acts chapter 8. That's our text. Acts chapter 8. We read from verse 1 to 4. Are we all there? If I dare say I'm there. Amen. Acts chapter 8, verse 1 to 4. Okay. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and healing men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Now from that verse, we saw that Paul consenting unto his death. Now this is a continuation of what happened in Acts in chapter 7. Let's go back to Acts chapter 7. Verse 56. I'd like us to go back so that we will be able to understand what actually was going on in that scripture. Acts chapter 7 verse 56 says, and said, "Behold, I see the heaven." This was Stephen. Now talking, say, "I see the heaven and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God." Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him, and the witness laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, "Lord, lay not these sins to their charge." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Praise the Lord. In chapter 8, where the rain, we said that Paul was consenting to the dead. This was after the death of Stephen. There was a great persecution in Jerusalem. The Christians, they were being persecuted. They were being killed. Now we see in that chapter 7 that when he was being persecuted, when he was about to be stoned to death, he knew that death was coming. He knew he was about to die. And he said, "Lord, receive my spirit." Now that gives us a view of how he sees death. He did not see death as death, but rather he sees death as a transition to a heavenly home. He sees it as an homecoming, like welcome home. And that is how God sees the death of a believer. When a believer, when he dies, he doesn't die like sinners. God doesn't see it as death. God sees it as a fulfillment that of his purpose for your life, that you've done with all that he has assigned you to do, and now you are coming home. And he knows that. And that is why he wasn't afraid in preaching the gospel. Because he had laid down his life for the gospel. And even unto death, he was still declaring the word. He was still declaring the word of God. But for sinners, how do they see death? They see death as death. At the end, because the first death, another death, no hope of what, of eternal life. And that is why you see that when God, when he sees death, you see when a believer dies, he says, and he does what? And he fell asleep. So as Christians, when we decide to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, we should know that, one, we have signed the death warrant. We have signed our life and with our life to him. That come without death or alive, we will do his will. Whether we are threatened or not, whether there is a great persecution or not, the gospel of Christ must be preached. So in that chapter 8 that we read, there was a great persecution in the church and the believers in Jerusalem. And the people, they were not afraid of declaring the word of God. They were not afraid being believers in the midst of that trial and persecution. Though the enemies, they did us for evil, but God had his own divine plan for all those instead, for the persecution of those believers. And that is what we are going to see here. See that the outbreak of persecution, which would have destroyed the church, actually produced a positive result. Now, God gave them an instruction that go ye into the world and do what? And preach the gospel. Not only in Jerusalem. We can see that in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witness unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and also the uttermost part of the earth. And at this time they were in Jerusalem. And the Bible makes us to understand that they did great job, and the church of God enlarged. Thousands and thousands of people, they were being converted to Christ. Thousands of people believed in the Lord Jesus. And the church, they remained in Jerusalem. The gospel was concentrated in what? In Jerusalem. It was not spreading out just according to what God had instructed in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. He told them that they shall be witnessed both in Jerusalem. And he didn't say that they would be witnessed only in where? In Jerusalem. But it was as if they had forgotten the commandment. It was as if they had forgotten the instruction that God had given. Judea was there. Samaria was there. The uttermost part of the earth was there. And the gospel must be spread among them. In Jerusalem, thousands of evangelists have sprung up. Thousands of deacons, deaconesses, prophets, prophetess, they have sprung up in Jerusalem. Believers, anointed people, gifted with the Holy Ghost, they were all there in Jerusalem, and the work of the Lord was increasing. And God wanted that work to spread around the whole place. And what happened? God allowed persecution to arise. It's very easy for us to feel that it was Paul, it was Saul, but God had an intention for it. He allowed the persecution to arise. And when the persecution, when it arose, as we see in Acts chapter 8, in Acts chapter 8 verse 4, it says, therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Then they went everywhere to start preaching the gospel. At that time that the persecution arose, they scattered everywhere. The believers. This time around, it was not the preachers, the pastors alone. It was not just the disciples, but what? All the believers. They went abroad, went everywhere, preaching the gospel. And the gospel was spread abroad. Though it was meant for evil, but God turned it for good. And if we see, he said, and so consenting unto the dead of unto his dead, and at that time there were a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the region of Judea and where? and Samaria. That was the instruction that God gave in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, that they should do what? Preach the word of God to where? In Jerusalem, in Judea, and in Samaria. They forgot the mission. They forgot it. They were just in one place. And when the persecution arose, then they went to where? To Samaria, and they went to Judea. And they started preaching what? The gospel. So we see that as believers, God has ordained us to declare the word of God. And whichever way thing that the Lord God have used to pull us out from our home, from our comfort zone, into a different land, into a different place, into a different location, it is for a purpose. It is for his divine plan and purpose. It's for his work. Like, for instance, in Nigeria, for instance, so many of us, we are born again in Nigeria, and we were in among what? We belong to a ministry, belong to a church, a worker. Something happened, either maybe difficulties, either maybe financial struggling, desire for a better life, and the Lord God used it to push us away from our zone into a foreign place, into America. Some are in UK, some are in India, some are in different countries. It is because of the spread of his word. It is not to go and make money. That is not the primary aim why the Lord God made it possible. It is not to pursue material things. That is not why God made that transition possible. It is for his work. And if we don't realize it, God has his own way of making us to do his purpose and to make his purpose for our life to be fulfilled. In the case of the Church of Jerusalem, it was persecution that arose and took them away from their comfort zone, and they end up declaring the word of the Lord. And God will help us, and we will all declare the work of the Lord in Jesus' name. That persecution arose with them. Let's look at Acts chapter 5 from verse 17. We'll see that whenever the Lord God allowed his people to move from one place to another, it's for his divine purpose. It's for his divine purpose to declare his word to all nations, to spread his word, and we will not disappoint him in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 5 from verse 17 to 21. Then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is a sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation, and laid their hands on the apostles, and put them in common prison. For the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison door and brought them forth and said, listening to that, verse 20, go and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Did you see that? All the word of what? Of this life. Do you know that there are people who don't know what life is all about? They feel that life is just all about their own, just to fulfill the works of the flesh. All the works of ways of this life is in the word of God, is in the gospel. It is not in the novel. It is not in our textbooks. Those ones are good. But the word of the life, they are in the word of God, in the Bible, in the scripture. He told them, go and tell them all the word of this life. They don't know what this life is all about. They don't know the purpose of life. They don't know the purpose of living. There are people living their life anyhow, wallowing in destruction and in sin. And God told them, go in the temple. Go and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Verse 21. And when they heard that, what did they do? And taught. Did you see that? When they heard it, they entered into what? The temple, and they began to teach. When I was going through all these verses, I began to ask myself, what instruction have God given me in His Word that I have not been carrying out faithfully in accordance? What is that thing that is swallowing up the instruction? Busyness, chasing this, chasing that, and the primary instruction of go ye into the world and preach the gospel is lying waste. Bible says that when they heard the word, they went and they preached the word and they speak to the people. As they obeyed, we obey in Jesus' name. We will preach the word in Jesus' name. That even in the midst of persecution, they did not give up. They did not retreat. They did not surrender. They were very conscious of their life. Because why? They've already given their life to Jesus. That is what we also mean when we say, I surrender all to Jesus. I give my life to Jesus. It is not just for butter and bread alone. But in times like this, that you give your life to Christ in fulfilling His will, using you to do His work, even unto death, you will not give up. And God will give us that boldness and courage in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians 15, 57 to 58 says, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abiding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Say, be steadfast, don't be unmovable. Don't be afraid. If they shut you down, keep speaking. Don't say, because I was shut down, and you stop speaking the word of God. And God will help us, will be unmovable, will be courageous in declaring the work of the Lord in Jesus' name. We will not be timid, just like we see here, that God has a purpose for everything. The persecution in Jerusalem was God's purpose to spread the word. If they had remained in Jerusalem, I don't think we would have received the word of God today. If they hadn't gone all over the place, into the uttermost part of the world, I don't think we would have received the word of the Lord. Now, it, in Jerusalem, it was not only those people in Jerusalem that went abroad everywhere preaching the gospel. In Acts chapter 11, verse 19, it says, "Now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as where? Phoenix and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but only the Jews. And some of them which were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which when they were come to Antioch, spake unto the Grecians, preaching the Lord Jesus." Now we'll see that they were there when their apostle, when their preacher was killed, Stephen was killed. They mourned him, they took him and they buried him. But still, but you'd have wondered that they would have run. You would think that as they ran, they've run to hide. You would think that if as they ran, as they left, they left and they kept quiet. You say, this is because of this gospel. That was why they killed Stephen. It is because of this gospel. That was why we lost our home. That was why we lost our job in where we were being before. We lost our children. Persecution. Parents couldn't find their children. Husbands could not find their wives. Wives couldn't find their husband. Everyone, they were scattered. But wherever they went, they did not allow the persecution to keep them timid. Here it says that upon the persecution, they went about. Now they have gone up above Syria. Now at this time, they've gone to Cyprus. They've gone to different places preaching the gospel. The persecution did not stop them from declaring the word of God. They lost their job. Some of them might be a company holder. Some of them might have billions in their account. Some of them might have millions buildings in Jerusalem, skyscrapers in Jerusalem. And persecution, they left all those things. But still, they were still preaching words, the gospel. All they count nothing for the cause of the gospel. And God is using this to challenge us. I don't think any of us have gone through this kind of persecution these people have gone through. What have you lost for Christ? What have you lost that you will say, because of this, I will not preach the gospel? Even when they flocked them and they told them, we don't want to hear you preach the gospel again in this place. They said, the law of this country says nobody should preach Jesus. They warned them. The government warned them. And the Bible says that at the moment they left, they went into the temple and they continued preaching the gospel. Because why? It's the power unto salvation. They don't know the word of life. And there you have the word of life. When they speak, they are speaking out of ignorance because they don't know the whole life. That is why they continue preaching the gospel. And the Lord God will give us that courage in Jesus' name. We'll go to the great progress despite great persecution. Great progress despite great persecution. At the time, there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. From the earlier chapter, there had been great persecution against the apostles, the leaders of the church at Jerusalem. They were threatened, they were beaten, they were imprisoned, But yet they kept on declaring the word of the Lord. And thousands upon thousands, they accepted Christ. Now, we are going to see something here in point one. Then we will go to point two. It's this. Let's go to Acts chapter 8. I'll read verse 1. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the region of Judea and Samaria. Now what follows? Can I hear you? Except the what? Apostles. What were they doing? Remember, now they have grown workers. They have grown enough thousands of disciples, large numbers. Now all those large numbers, they have been scattered where? Abroad, preaching the gospel because of the persecution that arose. Now, the Bible says that except the apostles, then what were they doing in Jerusalem? Meaning that now everybody is gone. The membership of the church in Jerusalem is few. It was now remaining them. But they kept on preaching the gospel, and they started growing the church again. There were other people in Jerusalem also who have not believed in word, in Jesus. Those who have believed, they've all gone now to preach the gospel. But there were people in Jerusalem who have not believed. Now, these apostles remained in Jerusalem to continue what? The ministry. They remained there and continued preaching the gospel. And the Bible said that more people were what? They were converted again. Fresh people started coming into the church. Let's look at Acts chapter 9, verse 26. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he assayed to join himself to the disciples. But they were all afraid of him, and believed not that he was the disciples. But But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly in Damascus in the name of Jesus. And he was with him, and he was with them, and he was with them, coming in and going out at Jerusalem. Verse 29, and they spoke boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus, and disputed against the Christians, but they went about to slay him. Now, what point was there is that at this time, all the people, they have gone. The same Saul that God used to disperse the people all over the world. Now all the people are gone. Then him now, he's now converted, came down to Jerusalem to join the disciples to start up the ministry in Jerusalem. You can see that despite the great persecution, they made what? Great progress. Despite all the members are gone, they made great progress. In verse 31, he said, then had the churches rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost, were multiplied. Those of them who went to Judea and Samaria, they made great progress. And when the apostles in Jerusalem, when they heard that the brethren in Jerusalem, in Samaria, in all over the places, that they are making great progress, what happened? They were all happy. The persecution brought joy and not sorrows to them. The Bible says that they remain there in Jerusalem. Why? Because you have the gift of God in you. The Holy Spirit is in you. That no matter where you go, the gift of the Spirit is in you. And what does the Bible say? That the gift of a man does what? Maketh room for him. And when you have the gift of the Spirit in you, anywhere you go, no matter the circumstances that comes about your movement, that comes about your transition, it's for a purpose. And the gift of God in you, you will keep on using it anywhere you are. And you will make great progress in Jesus' name. And we see that here, that they made great progress. And the Lord God will give us success in Jesus' name. Quickly go to point two, gospel proclamation by God's people. Gospel proclamation by God's people. Acts chapter 4, verse 8. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about how many? 5,000. We see that they made great work, great progress. What do you say? Yes, Acts chapter 8 verse 4. It said, therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. You see, they made what? They made great progress. And wherever we are, there is always an opportunity for us to declare the word of the Lord. In our conversation with friends, in our conversation with people, there's always a channel to put in the word of the Lord. And as we continue declaring the word of God, life will be transformed in Jesus' name. Did you know one thing, that persecution scattered the believers all over the places, all over the world, to the uttermost part of the earth, that is the world. But the suffering did not cause them to backslide. The suffering did not cause them to backslide. Despite the loss, they did not backslide. They remained fervent in the spirit. they did not murmur. They did not say, oh, because it's because we are preaching holiness. It's because we are telling the people that they should turn away from their sin. That is why we have been persecuted. They did not do that. They still continue to preach the undiluted word of God. They did not dilute the word. They did not water down the gospel and said, okay, maybe if we stop preaching it, they will stop persecuting us. They did not. They continued preaching the word. So no matter what we face for Christ, we should know that as a believer, we cannot die. We only sleep. That's why the Bible says that if you try to save your life, you will lose it. But if you give your life, what the Bible says, you will gain it. Maybe you say, I'm afraid they will cast me, they will persecute me, they will discriminate me, they will push me outside. They will not allow me to join them. And you are afraid of your life, and you are afraid of being in prison. And you refuse to declare the whole truth. You refuse to declare the word of God. You refuse to open the scripture to the sinner and say, this is the word of the Lord. This is the end of sin. That the wages of sin is there. Repent, that ye might live. And you are afraid of your life. At the end, that's life, you will lose it. But when you lose your life for the sake of Christ, you will gain it. Eternal life will be yours in Jesus' name. You see, they were not frightened. They used the gift that God had given to them to propagate the gospel, and they added to the church. And you know the joy and the happiness that was in heaven because of them. Instead of backsliding, they were more fervent. Their lust turned them to courageous preachers. They lost so many things. Like I said earlier, they have lost their houses, they lost their job. Some of them, they lost their children, they lost their wife, but still, they were not sorrowful. They were not self-pity. They start to pity themselves. Oh, why me? Why me? Why is all this happening to me for the sake of the gospel? No. No self-pity. And they were not, when I read all this act, these people, I did not see any prayer where they started praying, oh Lord, Father, please, oh, help us. They did not pray a prayer of fear. Like, God, please save us. Please protect us. Save our life. We don't want to die. Help. No. They did not pray a self-centered prayer, a fearful prayer. Even when Stephen, when he was stoned to death for the sake of the gospel, he would have prayed and said, Lord, please, let their hands to be frozen. I don't know. What did he say? He said, oh Lord, please don't God accept. But he knows that he has finished his work. He has fought a good fight. And the Lord God will give us understanding of what it takes to be a good soldier of Christ in Jesus' name. Persecution should never lead believers to compromise. You see, they did not compromise their faith despite the persecution. Even when the priest, when the synagogue, when they told them, don't preach the gospel again, they threw them in jail. Still, they continued preaching the gospel. They did not remove anything from the word of God. they continued preaching. They did not fear man. The fear of man did not cause them to backslide. You know, it's very easy to fear to fear man, but God has not given us the spirit of fear. They spoke to president. They spoke to king. They spoke even error. They spoke the word. They were not afraid of the terror of man. But they were only afraid of him who can kill the body and the soul in hell. And God will give us a fearless spirit in Jesus' name. Persecution should not drive us to greater prayerfulness. No, they continue praying. They continue consecrating themselves. They be mindful of heaven and courageous in their preaching. They did not lose the heavenly goal and say, why will I be going through this? Preaching the word of God. Look now, I am suffering. I don't have money in my pocket. I cannot pay my bill because I'm giving my time, I'm giving my service, my everything to the gospel. They did not say such things. They continued preaching the word. And they were more obedient to God's commandment that says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creation. They had been negligent of the whole commandment that God gave to them, that they should not just remain in Jerusalem, that they should go into everywhere to preach the gospel. But when the persecution came, it did not cause them to disobey more. What happened? It caused them to do what? To complete obedience. It pushed them into complete what? Obedience. In Samaria, in Judea, and uttermost part of the world. And at that time, persecution made them to obey God completely. And their obedience, it was what? It was complete. So our obedience to God in one area of life, one aspect of life, should not be a license for us to disobey God in other aspects. God wants us to do what? To obey him completely. And that is why, and these people, they have grind themselves in the word of the Lord in their secret. And that what you see in the open is a manifestation of what they have done in closed doors. It's a manifestation of the consecration that they have made to God in their private. It is a manifestation of their devotion, of their prayer, of their studying of the word of God in their closet. And that is what you see in the open. And that when the test came, they did not shake. They stood courageously. And the Lord God will help us to consecrate ourselves to him in Jesus' name. That our consecration should not just be only when we come to church in the midst of the brethren. We say, I surrender. And in our closet, we are not fully consecrated and maintaining that strong relationship with God. And if we don't have that strong relationship, when persecution comes, when prayers come, we murmur, we draw back. And the Bible says that we are not of them that draw back. And you will not draw back, I will not draw back in Jesus' name. Okay, think glorious pattern for global penetration. Now, we see the pattern that they use. The pattern that they use in declaring the word of God. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. But in this point three, we see that there is an individual pattern, more personal evangelism, one-to-one evangelism, declaring the word of God on your own. When you go, I might not be where you are, you might not be where I am, but wherever you are, wherever you may be, declaring the word of the Lord, turning souls to the Lord Jesus Christ. And that will be our portion and our activity in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Now, first, wherever they were, they were all there. Some of them were alone, individual. At this time, they were not going as group, because everybody was what? It's like to your tent, old what? Old Israel. That was the way it was. But wherever they were, they continued doing what? Preaching the gospel. And we see that pattern there. Look at yourself in the whole of this month. Where have you been? Maybe for instance, tomorrow, where will you go? Sometimes you go to the school. Maybe you go to the school, you go to work. You go to this place. Where you will go is not where I will go. Where I will be is not where you will be. But irrespective of you, to declare the word of the Lord. Always make sure you have the gospel tract in you. And even if there is no time for you to talk to the person, giving the tract alone and telling the person to be coming, Jesus is coming soon. Telling just give the person 2 seconds, declaring the word and give the tract. And that publication will go a long way in turning them to Christ. Chapter 8, verse 25. And they, when they had testified, preached the word of God, returned to Jerusalem, which the gospel of many villages of the west. The Samaritan. Now we see the evangelistic work there. That is the work of an evangelist. The evangelical pattern. They were telling him, he said, stay. Why don't you just stay? He said, no. There are people also who have not, I must go to preach what? He you see, that one kind of like, it's like an overseer. It's like a pastor in the church. No, sometimes they go to different churches, they go to different places, holding crusades, preaching what? The gospel. And the gospel is not just concentrated in one area. That wherever we go, we should keep on preaching what? The gospel. If we are preaching that gospel, what happens? We are snatching the people from the hands of the enemy. Joy in heaven over what? A sinner that repented from their sin. And also, we see that the ministry of declaring the word of God, it is not just for men only, it is also for women also. It's not just, and it is not a duty, a work for the pastor only. It is the work for every believer, every Christian. If you are born again, assignment that God has given unto every one of us to preach the word of God. We are going to see John chapter 4. Read from verse 21. Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. True worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is the Spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee, I that speak unto thee, am he. 27. And upon this came his disciples, and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, What seekest thou? Or why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went away into the city and said to the men, Come and see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came on to him. We see that this was her first time of meeting Jesus. This is her first time of having an encounter with the Lord. You can call her what? A new convert that she just converted. The moment she converted, she started what? Preaching the gospel. And if you read further, you will see that those people that she spoke to, they came and they heard the word of the Lord and they believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. So it doesn't matter how long you have been in the church. It doesn't matter how long you give your life to Christ. You can be born again today. The mantle has been handed over to you. No time to waste. No time to wait. Continue preaching the word in season and out of season. If you are a man, declare the word. If you are a woman, declare the word. And the Lord God will help us to succeed in Jesus. Jesus' name. There is no questions for this lesson here. If there's any question, Meditation should not kind of like take us to prayerful kind of meditation. Meditation should change our prayer life. That's what I was trying to bring up. Yeah, it shouldn't kind of like reduce our prayer life. Challenges help us to be stronger in you and be devoted in declaring your word in Jesus' name. May it not cause us to backslide. May it not cause us, oh God, to be lukewarm. May challenges not cause us, oh God, to be fearful. May it not cause us to draw back. Father, but rather, it will strive us to be more prayerful, more devoted, more committed to your work in Jesus' name. But just like they made great progress, despite the great persecution, Father, there are many challenges that are facing us today. Father, in the midst of great challenges facing us, Father, we will make great progress in Jesus' name. Every problem, every challenge will be a stepping stone to a greater height in Jesus' name. Father, we commit as many churches, believers, and saints all over the world to your hand. Father, so many of them are going through this same thing that the disciples and the believers went through in Jerusalem. just like you gave them success, just like you turned everything for good to them. Father, turn it for good in this dispensation in Jesus' name. Father, and at the end, we all rejoice. And we all triumph in the missionary work, in the evangelical work, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' name we pray.
Praise the Lord. God will help every one of us in Jesus' name. If not because of we are very limited in the church today, I will have asked all the children should go upstairs because of their sleeping. But God will help us in Jesus' name. He told us we should always prepare them for service. I heard that, okay, today is Saturday, we are going to the church tomorrow. Let us able to be disciplining them as our leaders are disciplining us. If our leader doesn't pardon us, we shouldn't be pardoning them too. And God is going to help us in Jesus' name. Initially, I want to talk about when believers sleep, and then when I go there, our teacher can see that I've been so busy planning to talk about when believer sleeps. But because of the question that came up, I really appreciate how our teacher answered the question, that when somebody that has been active in the church and has been coming to the church is like it started showing a care attitude, what should we do? You know, backsliding doesn't start in a day. It's not one day. And then if you look at many of us, many people that stand in the Lord, and then they did not go back despite all what happened to them. They have committed themselves from the beginning that said, this Jesus Christ, no matter what happened, I'm going to follow him to the end. They may have challenges along the line that a little bit want them to be say, no, God, I'm not going to follow you again. But it's not possible. They always be constant. And then you can see the life of Jonah. When God give him an error. He is not even that he went back from the Lord. The only thing is that he doesn't want to carry out that instruction. But because of his relationship with God, because of his how he loved God, how God loved him, see what he went through until he delivered the message of God. It doesn't go. It did not say bye-bye. God, I'm not going to do that. Bye-bye. We can see many people in that way. And the example is Judas. In the book of Mark, chapter 14, 44. Book of Mark, chapter 14, 44. This is the disciple, one of the 12, that have been following Jesus Christ all the day Jesus Christ was preaching. I know if there's anything I must have told you that I so appreciate so much is the Sermon on the Mount. Judas was there. I don't know if any one of us will have sat down once to read that Sermon on the Mount and see how full it was. We read it. Judas himself was there when Jesus Christ was preaching it. And then many of us, we know the importance of this. That, okay, look at when we have any of our leader around us or in Washington, D.C. We have been listening to their cassette. We have been listening to their message on maybe on audio, online, or somewhere. When we see they are present, you see the impact of that message in our life. I don't want to say more than the one we have been listening to the message. I don't want you to look at that way. But you will see that the presence of them always mean a lot to us. Then Judas was there when Jesus Christ was preaching that message. If that message is the Sermon on the Mount, can convert millions of millions of millions of people. What should we expect? That is that message you able to convert Judas totally, to the extent that no matter what the situation may be, it will stand like other 12. But there was something he was greedy about, and that was money. Many people said maybe he has been spending those money before, and he doesn't want anybody to say. From the theological level, many people believe that it must be done. But if it's going to be done, why through Judas, who is among the 12? That's why Jesus Christ, it would have been better if that person is not born than being a betrayer. So what I'm trying to say is this. That person must have been planning the evil in himself. Not in one day he stopped coming. He must not have a very strong fit in that message. It may be somebody we have been telling that this thing you are doing is not good. And it is not part of Christianity. And if you want to be part of us, you need to join, you need to stop all those things. They are agents. Devil want to use, and devil can use, and devil use to take away people from Jesus Christ. Those people, they will not stop it. They will keep doing it. You will just, one day you just suddenly, that person does not come to the church again. It is not because anybody offended him. I want you to know. It is not because church is not good. I want you to know. It is not because that particular time something happened in the church. I want you to know. It is because from the beginning, he doesn't have a strong in the word of the Lord. And that's why they easily go back. There are a lot of challenges. And the challenges is this. I'm going to die for the world. No, it's not possible. You cannot die, my Lord, my Jesus Christ. You devil, go behind me. Peter did not say, because Jesus called him devil, then he said, that's why my loyalty, that's why that I love you, that's why I'm doing all these things, you still call me devil. Bye-bye from today. Why? Because he has already has a strong faith in the word of the Lord. Okay, you want to take my master? Who are you? Sword. Boom. He called the air. Then Jesus Christ took that thing back. He put it back. See this man. They will rather kill you many times today. I'm no more yourself. I'm not. I want to defend you. But still see what you are. See what I'm doing. Peter did not say that. I will get to area where you may be thinking that, okay, at this particular time. But Peter did not say that. Why? He has a strong faith in the word of the Lord. So when you see somebody that said no because of Jesus Christ is not good, because Jesus Christ said this, because they do this in the church, because this person do this many times, husband and wife, we offend ourselves. Why you don't run away? Many times, children offend mother offend children. Why you don't run away? That it is when you see a single something in the church, just something of 5 minutes, and then you have a wife, you are living for more than 10 years, more than 15 years, you offend each other, and you are still staying together. Just because of love. Then if you love that Jesus Christ, if something happened in the church in a meeting, that thing is not enough to run you away. Let us be sincere. Let us be sincere to ourselves. Except already before then, it is one leg out, one leg in. So I'm going to this, and then I want to tell you from my experience, even in since we come to Charlotte, not even Charlotte, go and look at any people that leave the church. Go and look at what we have been observing from the beginning. You will see that they have been compromising. This is a sister. He's loyal to the church. This is another sister. He's loyal to the church. Not that wearing crosses is bad. There's a lot of things we do just because of whom we are. We don't want to do it so that people will not say we joined the world. Okay. This sister said, because of my commitment to my church, to the word of the Lord, to whatever God says, this trouser, no matter what the case they will, I will not put it on. Even if they are going to give me $1 million, I'm not ready to put it on. It's not sin. The culture here may be different from this culture, but the Bible says this. You get what I'm saying? I'm just bringing an example. Another sister there. Is it not because of the work? Is it not just because I should be eating? After all, just 8 hours in a day, I will continue to manage that trouser as far as I'm not wearing it to the church. But I'm wearing it in the work because of the work. Okay. The other sister that said, okay, I'm not going to put on this trouser. Before the battle was won. The management said, okay, we accept your condition. If you don't want to wear this trouser, it's okay. But wear this kind of sketch, wear this kind of sketch. The other sister keep wearing the trouser. and believe that, okay, he's coming to the church, he will not wear the trouser. But in a long time, in the middle of time, something happened. The other sister that is wearing the trouser said, I'm not coming to the church again. But all what has been happening to the other sister that is wearing the skirt, no matter what happened, she remain in the church. When does the compromising start? When does it start? It starts from the day the sister that was wearing trouser compromised. That is it not just because of wearing it to the work? Are we continue to wear it? It's not sin. Compromising have started from that day. So do not be surprised if anything happen at the long run. Already it has given a room for compromising. I think you get what I'm saying. 10 years ago, I'm not the doctrine. This is what the Bible says. Okay, but we find ourselves in a new situation. You get what I'm saying? We find that okay. You cannot walk here without putting on trouser. The other sister said, no, it's not possible. This is my faith. You may claim it, you may say this, but this is my faith. I said. But the other sister said, okay, is it not because of it's just because of money, because of this situation? If I don't wear this trouser, I will not secure a job. She started wearing this trouser. You know, compromising has come by saying, I will start wearing this trouser. I don't say it's a sin. No matter way, no matter how you judge it. You get what I'm saying? But already, you get what I'm saying? But it does not wear it to the church. You get what? Well, he's wearing it. Even somebody like me may not know. Until one day, maybe I met her on the road. I'm like, so this woman, she's wearing trouser. But already, you know, she has allowed compromising. You get what? She has allowed compromising from the day she said, I'm going to be wearing this trouser. She has compromised from the standard of the church. But the other sister that said, I'm not going to be wearing the trouser, she has not compromised. Then little thing happens. Then the other sister that had been wearing the trouser said, no, I'm leaving this church. What do you expect? You have been expecting that one day you will leave the church, because one day he has already compromised. So, that somebody said, I'm going, it's not a day. It is because that particular person does not have faith in Jesus. As many of us who are leaders in the church, including those people who are leaders that see visitors, there's a lot of things that has happened and will remain in that church forever. Why? Because we have decided that this is where Jesus Christ is and this is where I'm going to stay. There are a lot of things. Many people, if I say many of you or many people that I've dealt with, sometimes they threat me and I will not come to the church again. It's always very, very annoying. It is true. Nobody will build something like this and it wants it to scatter. And in my corridor, in my secret, I may be praying that God build this church. I don't want it to scatter. If it be just three of us, if we can get to the kingdom of God, it's okay. But threaten me that I'm not going to be coming to the church. Are you threatening me or you are threatening your faith? Where is your faith? You said that's why Paul was talking to Galatians. That's why Paul was talking to Galatians. That all you foolish. That's what all what we have done together, we eat together. That's why all what we have done together, we share together. That's why all what we have done together, I open my mind to you together. That's why all what we have done together, I have no secret to any one of you. That's why all what I'm there. Why I even need prayer? I humble myself to say, you, member of the church, pray for me. That's why all what I've done together, we have done together, I do not exert myself. That's why a lot of things we have done together, you people of Galatia, and you are still this. Let's go to the book of Galatians. Let's look at it. Let's look at from first one. I want to show us something today. We have time. I don't care if we don't do all other activities. I like preaching the word of the Lord when it comes to the preaching the word of the Lord. Look at go to the book of Romans. Go to the book of Romans. So, you know, we are still on, it is not the church. It is not nobody send that particular person away. It is because that person does not have Christ himself. He has been compromising from before. And we have been telling him that this thing you are doing, although we don't want to send you away, we are not the owner of the church. God is the owner of the church. But this is the foundation that was laid. And we want you to build on that foundation. Although you are compromising, we are associating with you, that does not change our own foundation. All what we are telling you is this. Be careful. Drop this thing in your name. It will ruin your life. If that person wake up one morning and say he's not coming to the church, you shouldn't be surprised. He has been compromising before. Paul was talking to the Romans. He was saying, look at the book of Romans, look at what's happened. You know, when Paul is writing letter, he writes in five stages. I, Paul, he will greet them, then he will tell them all what they have done that was surprising him. Now he will send them the message he wants to them. He will now tell them at the end, I'm thanking God for you. I'm thanking God. This is my mission. This is another mission. Look at the book of Romans. Look at the book of Romans. When Paul was writing to Romans, he said, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be apostle, separate unto the gospel of God. He introduced himself very well to them. Now, go to verse 7. To all whom be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints. Then, look at verse 9. Look at verse 8. I'm going to verse 8. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. You see? He said, I thank God for you, because your faith is made throughout the whole world. We have known you. Go to book of 1 Corinthians. I will show you something in Galatians. But I want you to know If you see anybody that backslide, that person has been planning to backslide. He has been compromising. It's just that he has not, we have been telling him, just that he, I mean, he didn't listen. Look at 1 Corinthians. Look at how the same way Paul wrote the book of Romans, greeting them. Paul called to be an apostle unto the church of God. See, look at verse 4. I thank my God always on your behalf. He says, thank God on their behalf. When you look at all the letters of Paul, you see all those things there. I thank God. But when it comes to the book of Galatians, look at what Paul said. I marvel that you are so removed from him who called you into grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. But there be some who trouble you and who perfect the gospel of... Paul did not thank God because of the people of Galatians. The same way many of us, we know. We see your secret life. We see your open life. And we are praying that God taught this. But if one day you say, because the pastor do this, the pastor, it's not pastor that do it. It is your intention. Because all the message pastors have even been preaching before. There's no one. We call you in secret, we call you open, we call you every time that change. So there's no way to be threatened that I'm going to leave the church. Truly, I will beg you. Truly, I will say why. Truly, I will cry that for all this long hour. But my dear brother, my dear sister, Galatian people do it. Those kind of people, they are fake. They are not genuine. The kind of that people is Judas. He was a fake disciple.
I've never read why Judas was rebuked like Peter.
But he remained steadfast to the last. To the end that we can read about the book of Peter in the Bible, you can never read the book of Judas, except the compromise one outside.
So if we are telling you, if the leader are telling us that this is what I want, this is what I want, this is my belief, this is my belief.
My dear brother, my dear sister in the Lord, remain faithful to your calling under them. And surely God is going to open way in Jesus' name. In the book of 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10.
For Demas have forsaken me, having loved the present world, and he is departed unto
Thessalonica. That brother Demas, he has been loved the world, even when he was with Paul.
So when the great opportunity comes for him to admire his lovely flesh, he left Paul.
My dear brother, not Paul did anything. No pastor do anything for them to live. It is their own self desire. Many of us, we have cried, even our own age, like a baby.
Just because that shall do this, that shall not do this.
And we still there.
Many of what we are going to extra prayer
On God, I want you, my leader, to understand me. We are still there.
Many of our leaders, I'm trying to caution myself now because of personal example, but the last time we meet with one of our leaders, one of our leaders was saying, if for some time you are preaching good messages and you are expecting that message to be out in audio, not, you know, everybody like praise, everybody like appreciation. Then they release the messages of other people. Your own messages is not released just because of one thing or the other. They still in the church till today and they are worshiping God. And then many of them want to go, it's like, oh, God has given me another assignment, and how is this going to work? They live with a peace, not just Sudan. And then I don't want you to go now. Yes, sir. So this brother Mas, he has been compromising his brotherhood from the time, it's funny, because it's not easy to be in Christ and be in the world. How did he look back to the essence that he now loved the world that Paul has said bye bye to? Show me your master, I will show you whom you are. And when the time come, he went back to his master. Who is the master of the world? But look unto Peter. In the book of John 21:15. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. This is Peter. Then despite a lot of things, all of us too, we may be in the dark end of the darkness, desert. That Jesus Christ, everybody know as our leader. And that as a result of him, they are respecting us. He was the one that preaching all this message. Now, I remember when there's no food. He provided food for us, including those people who are following us. They brought a lot of people. We are praying for them. Our prayer was not answered. But they brought these people into Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ laid his hand on them, and they were healed. This is the man that sent down demons. Now, this man has gone. Father, what will be my faith? He may be in that kind of situation. Then Peter said, instead of being facing this trial alone, facing this trouble alone, I will go back to my work. He thought about what some of us may be in that kind of situation. For failure to be able to pray. But what happened? Because Jesus Christ knew that Peter loved him. What did Jesus Christ do? He appeared unto him again. Peter, don't you know how you love me? Why is very short time you go back into fishing? You are no more a fisher, you are now a fisher of men. And do you see what he said? I love you. But do not forget this, Peter. There was a time he was back up from Jesus Christ. And then when the crowd, the sound was made in the top, crowd, third time, or what do we say it? You know, Peter wept. Have you forgotten it? That's how you know how he loved him, to the extent that it was easy for him to come back. Because Peter loved Jesus Christ to the extent that he wept when he saw that he has denied Jesus. You can see difference. Demas went, he didn't look back. Judas did all what he wanted. All the time he was having meeting with them, he was doing a lot of things. He even collected money. Then it was the grace. Then instead of coming by, he went and devil has totally occupied him. He went and killed himself. But Peter didn't do that. He wept with sincerity of mind. And Jesus Christ saw it in him. And when he went back to the fishing, Jesus go back to him and call him, "Come back, my dear boy. It is you I promise that upon you we build this." What happened? Peter came back. It was not difficult. It is not mentioning of the. Jesus was even answering me, questioning him, "Do you love me?" It's not that, "Peter, if you love me, I'm begging you, come. Do not forget, it is on you I build this rock." He boldly asked him, "Do you love me more than this?" And Peter answered, "Yes, you know, I love you more than this." What did he do? But many of them, after they are born, you go to their house, you play with them, then they will be looking for an excuse. Is your pastor God? That I need to come to your house and be begging you because you will come to the church? And we rather use that hour to pray for Holy Spirit. God, the church is in your hand. Why can't you just take my life? So there have been a lot of compromises. And those people are not ready. They are just coming for coming's sake. They are not the member of the kingdom. And a little thing, they started threatening you. I will not come to the church again. Why are you coming? Are you giving me money?